Good morning, sir.
So good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Good morning, parents. A warm welcome to all of you. It's
very
nice
good
to
morning.
Have you all online. Yes, it's really nice. I'm happy to see so many parents online. I hope more parents will join as we go through this session. Also, a warm welcome to Dr. Vikram, who's our guest over here. Ms. Rakhi, our coordinator, will introduce him a little later. So I'd just like to say a few words, parents. This week is our safety week, which we celebrate every year. You know, we have a lot of activities every year, and it's usually a very busy week for us, where we start off the week with an assembly and we educate our children about all kinds of safety. We have dogs, we make them do activities. In fact, last year we had a fantastic fire evacuation drill with the children. Were so good with. So obviously this year we have our challenges, but we still feel our children need to be educated, you know, with regard to various types of safety that they need to follow, whether it is good touch, bad touch, whether it is health or it is cyber safety. So in keeping with what we've been doing, we arranged this session, and we're very happy that we have a doctor who's ready to, you know, talk to you all about it, because with this pandemic around us, we have too many challenges with our children. And in fact, the safety of our children is what is most important right now, how to keep them safe. And when we say safe, it's not just physical safety, it's also mental, it's also emotional safety, because we all know what we've been going through. And sometimes we don't understand what's going into the minds of these little ones. So it's really nice to have you all here with us. And in fact, you can see we have our principal here. My esteemed principal, Mr. Brown, is also here. Ms. Rakhi, our primary coordinator, is also here. And we look forward to this session where we hope our parents will definitely benefit. So maybe if Mr. Brown would like to say a few words, a hello maybe to all the parents.
Yeah, hi parents. I just want to reiterate what Ms. Catherine just mentioned. To us, the safety and security of the children are paramount. And this safety week is something that I started in school right from its inception. So every year we have it. It's very traditional here at Greenbridge, one of the very rare. Because of the fact that we believe that the child is the center of all that we do here in the school. And we are very, very concerned about our babies. And we want to ensure that they grow up in a beautiful environment, appreciating the wonderful world in which we were, you know, privileged to be born into. And how we should not only take care of our surroundings, but also take care of us, body, mind, and soul. So I don't think I'll take up any more of your time. Once again, a very warm welcome to all of you. And Dr. Vikram, thank you so much for your time. And I'm sure at the end of the session, all of us are going to be enlightened by what you have to advise and tell us. Thank you, Dr. Vikram, once again.
Yeah. So, Ms. Rakhi would like to introduce our esteemed guest on this session. Yes, Ms. Rakhi, go ahead.
Good morning, everyone. As Ms. Karen has already talked about Dr. Vikram is MD Pediatrics. He is a professor of Pediatrics, Subbaiah Medical College, Shimoga. He is here with us for a question answer session, wherein you all can ask all any kind of doubts and questions pertaining to your children's health and safety. And he is here to answer. So, Mr. Vikram, Dr. Vikram, you are most welcome. And parents, you are welcome here to ask any kind of questions. And Dr. Vikram will be directly answering you.
Yeah, I would like to ask all parents to please write the questions in the chat box so that I can send it to doctor, because everybody barging together would be disturbing and we won't understand what question is coming up.
Can I say something?
Yeah, sure, sir. Yeah.
Thank you, everyone. Good morning. And thanks for this invite. Before we begin the Q&A, I thought I'll just share a few important things about the topic for 5 minutes, and maybe after 5 minutes, I can take questions. Can I go ahead?
Sure, sir.
Yeah. COVID has been scary. Parents are rightly worried for their children in terms of their health and safety. I've been asked quite a few times, you know, what vitamins can I give my child to prevent them from getting COVID? Unfortunately, there is no proof yet that any nutrient, supplements, vitamins can help. This is a virus, and viruses don't care about vitamin levels. While giving additional vitamins and supplements on top of what your child normally would need has not been scientifically proven to help boost immunity to viruses, it is certainly important to keep giving your children healthy foods and make sure they get lots of sunshine and exercise to keep their immune systems primed and ready to fight off COVID or, for that matter, any infection that we may get. Preventing illnesses, especially during the current COVID-19 pandemic, is at the top of all of our minds. While it's not practical to think that we can avoid 100% of illnesses, having a healthy immune system is an important part of boosting our natural defenses. One key way to keep our natural defenses strong is by eating a balanced and varied diet. It is also recommended to limit or avoid highly processed foods such as pizzas, burgers, cake, cookies, biscuits, chips, wafers, and all that are low in nutrition and often take the place of more nutrient-dense foods. The pandemic actually has focused attention on the role of immune system, with experts and articles urging people to buy supplements and eat particular foods to turbocharge their immune systems. It's actually laughable and have got no scientific basis. The truth is actually more subtle, as highlighted by the recent World Health Organization and also a lot of National Pediatric Association. A healthy lifestyle makes all bodily functions work better, including immunity. Having a healthy diet that includes lots of fruits, vegetables, is a key component of a healthy lifestyle. And two, three questions that I keep getting asked commonly are, one, how does the immune system work? I'm sure a lot of parents here would also have the same question. What exactly is the immune system and how exactly does our immune system work? Well, you know what? This pandemic has opened a Pandora's box about how immune system works. And believe me, not even the best of researchers and scientists across the world have been able to decipher how exactly our immune system works. We know a bit, but we are far away from knowing how exactly the immune system works. So I too am ignorant to that extent. But what is known to us is that immune system is one of the most complex bodily systems. You can say it is as complex as our brain, because brain is also an important part or aspect of your immune system. It is made up of a network of cells, molecules, tissues, and organs all working together in harmony to protect the body. This complexity means, you have to understand this, this complexity of immune system, which also includes your brain, means that it cannot be modified acutely by a specific nutritional intervention. By this I mean you just can't give certain supplements or nutrients or some immune boosting drugs to modify your immune system to fight against a particular virus or a bacteria in a matter of few days or few weeks. Rather, adhering to a healthy diet, healthy lifestyle practices provides ongoing support to your immune system and may even delay the process of what is called as immunosenescence. We all know what senescence is. Senescence is aging of the body. There is also a terminology called as immunosenescence, aging of the immune system. So if we can maintain a healthy lifestyle and if we can get rid of modifiable risk factors, we can prevent, to an extent, accelerated aging of our immune systems as well. Okay, so this is in brief that I thought everyone should know about what exactly the immune system is. The next question that I keep getting most commonly is, I'm sure all the parents would also be having this question in their minds and would like to ask this, is, can nutrition boost your immune system? I've already told you it can boost, but acutely, you know, in a matter of few days or few weeks, you give some nutritional supplement and your body is ready to protect you from all sorts of viruses is a false notion and it is laughable. We've seen this going around on social network and also many TV channels telecasting this. It's laughable and has got no scientific basis. However, simply put, you just can't boost your immune system only through diet. There is no specific food or supplement that will prevent you or your child from catching COVID-19 or coronavirus. Okay. However, good hygiene practice remains the best means of avoiding infection in the form of wearing masks, maintaining physical distancing. I think more than social distancing, the word that we all should start using is physical distancing. We can maintain social contact by maintaining physical distancing. So social distancing is not a very good terminology to use. We have to maintain physical distancing, yet remaining in social contact. There are many nutrients that are involved in normal functioning of the immune system. Many vitamins, trace minerals like iron, folate, copper, selenium, zinc and all. Most of the balanced diet that we consume have these in adequate amounts. No one particular food is recommended over another, and eating a variety of foods will help to maintain a healthy balanced diet. The immunoprotection of many of these nutrients is based on their what we call as antioxidant capacity, and discussing what antioxidant capacity is beyond today's is beyond the scope of today's discussion. It is important to really consider consulting a registered dietitian or a pediatrician or a consultant physician to make any significant changes to your diet or your child's diet. Okay. So the last and probably the most important question that I keep getting is, what is the guidance on protecting your immune system? Is there any rule of thumb to protect your immune system? Quite simple. We have to get back to our roots. We have to start practicing what our grandparents used to do. And it's quite simple. It not only protects you from communicable diseases, that is infectious diseases, but also will protect you from a lot of non-communicable diseases. Non-communicable diseases include hypertension, diabetes, endocrinological problems, and also cancers. So what is the simple rule of thumb? Have a healthy weight. Have a healthy weight. About a decade or two ago, in children especially, the problem was underweight. But now, the problem is with overweight and obesity. This is same even with adults and adolescents. We have been eating like, we have a problem of surplus, rather to say, that we've been eating too much and exercising too little. So weight issues, especially overweight issues, are becoming more and more across the world. Maintain a healthy weight. To maintain a healthy weight, you should be physically active. So you have to be physically active. And I'm sure if you touch your heart and introspect, you know that your physical activity has gone down big time. If you compare your physical activity with your parents, or for that matter with your grandparents, I think it has come down by more than 90%. So that is again contributing to your morbidities. Ensure you eat whole grains, fruits, vegetables, pulses. Next is, please limit fast foods. Get your children out of this habit of eating fast foods. Fast foods in general would be any food that you buy from bakeries and all the other eating outlets, you know, Domino's, Pizza Hut, KFC, McDonald's and all those things. You have to limit it. Or better thing would be to completely avoid. Fast foods came into existence because man started traveling. But now when you are in a when you are stationed at a single at your home, I don't think you need to rely on fast foods for your daily sustenance. Please limit red and processed meat. Okay, this is a controversy, but many studies have shown that you have to limit your red, especially Indians need to limit on red and processed meat. Completely avoid sugar sweetened drinks. And adults, please don't consume alcohol in front of your children, and make sure your adolescents don't get into this habit of consuming liquor. And also adults need to stop smoking in front of their children and ensure that your child or an adolescent doesn't get into this habit of smoking. Please don't rely on supplements. The last and the most important thing, which I had to keep it at last because now we are in a very desperate situation, that most of the learning is happening on online. Excessive screen time and exposure to radiation needs to be curtailed in children because it is known to aggravate poor vision, aggravate anxiety disorders, and also aggravate physiological autistic behavior. That is, it can aggravate socially withdrawing behaviors. An introvertish child can become more introvertish. A child who was otherwise normal can become introvert. So these are simple things that are easily followable, but we make a mess out of it. So ensure that these simple things are taken care of, and I bet most of us will live a very healthy life. I'll stop here.
Okay. So there's a first question. What is the cause behind excessive sweating in hands and feet in kids?
This is not a very common problem, though 10 out of 1,000 kids can have it. We call it as physiological hyperhidrosis, wherein the hands and the soles can become excessively sweaty. It can be aggravated by certain anxious situations, especially writing exams or going on stage and all those things. It's genetic. There are hereditary causes to it. I'm sure whoever has asked it in their children might have themselves have suffered it or might still be having it. It's just because that certain situations and also in few children, even otherwise normally, certain nerves supplying the hands and soles are, especially the sweat glands, are overactive. So that can make them sweat a lot. Certain behavioral changes can be utilized in order to overcome the disadvantages due to this oversweating in the palms and soles. We'll not go into the details of it, but believe me, it's quite, it's seen even in normal kids. So they can consult their pediatrician. There are certain creams that can be used, especially while writing, because I've come across parents complaining that while their kids are writing, they sweat so much that the paper gets wet. So in such circumstances, there are certain creams that can be applied to their palms and soles before writing their exams or any other activities.
Okay, hello?
Yeah.
Yeah, so next question is, how do I know the amount of milk to give my kids every day? Is it true that having more milk will reduce iron absorption?
That's a good question. You know what, contrary to the belief that we have had that you need to drink a certain quantity of milk every day, scientifically, it's not proven because milk gives you around, 100 ml of milk gives you around 70 kilocalories. and around 3 grams of proteins. So that can easily be given by a single morsel of cereal. And again, contrary to the belief that milk has got a lot of calcium, that is not really true. If you were to take the animal kingdom as the whole, humans are the only ones who are still dependent on milk after they have outgrown their milk growing behavior. We don't really have to drink milk. It's not really required. There are no set guidelines to say this amount of milk needs to be given to a child of this age. If a child is fussy or if a child is hooked on to milk as the main source of calories or proteins, it is not a good habit. We have to get rid of that habit as parents, because as the second part of the question comes, if a child is hooked up to too much of milk, more than say about 750 ml per day, there is a significant chance that especially cow milk can hinder absorption of iron. But it doesn't happen if milk is given as a routine, you can say, complement once or twice a day, about 150 ml per serving. That wouldn't hinder absorption of iron. Having said that, any consumption of milk more than 750 ml per day as a predominant source of calories or proteins can not only cause iron malabsorption, not in all kids, but in certain kids, but also can cause milk protein allergies. So what I would say is, don't really rely upon milk as a good milk as an important source of diet every day. You can limit milk to an extent that my children don't drink milk at all. I don't really bother whether they have had milk or not in their daily consumption of food. Rather focus on giving semi-solid feeds or improving the routine balanced food or routine home cooked food, solid food, than really bothering about the quantity of milk that needs to be given.
So next question is, could you also recommend good source of micronutrients for vegetarians who doesn't eat egg?
I've already told you, colored vegetables, green leafy vegetables, all fruits, they all give you enough micronutrients. No particular supplements are required.
Okay. There's a teenager question. My daughter, who is teenaged, has reduced her weight since COVID started. In her appetite has gone down. How do I help it?
Okay. So a teenage girl has stopped eating since COVID pandemic has begun, and she has become a fussy eater, is it? She's not eating well.
Yeah, that's how the question is.
Okay, probably she must have developed certain teenage related behavioral maladjustment personality.
Mm-hmm.
It's better that they take her to an adolescent practitioner or a pediatrician, because this has been taxing, you know, this pandemic has been taxing on not only adolescents but also adults. It can sometimes see pandemic or any stressor can induce a latent behavioral personality disorder in any person.
Okay.
So it is better to take your teenage child to a pediatrician or a adolescent consultant, because it needs counseling. And it needs proper questioning and also proper assessment as to what exactly has triggered her behavior for her to eat less, which has led her weight loss. It can't be discussed over a Q&A session.
Okay, sir. Next question is, concentration is less in my child when we instruct her to do. Every 2-3 minutes, she gets to play more. And second point is, can you suggest some increasing blood in body for child because she is underweight?
Okay. See, concentration issues. I mean, for anyone to do anything, they will have to sit at one place and concentrate on a particular activity. concentration ability is a very important aspect of growing up of a child, and also certain maturity aspects of the brain. If your child is unable to sit at one, what is the age of the child? I just wanted to know.
Nearly 8-9.
Okay, so 8 to 9 years of age child unable to sit at one place, cannot concentrate beyond 2 minutes, is not a good symptom. No, probably the child has attention span issues, because there are a few problems wherein a child has attention span issues. One, the most common would be behavioral, what we call as a type of hyperkinetic disorders. The most commonly we know it as attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD. The other thing would be, the other common thing would be if a child has learning disability. If a child has some problem with learning, the child is not interested in doing that. So the best way to get out of the situation is to show that it is not concentrating, or it is not attentive. So we have to rule out in this child whether your child has problems in learning a particular topic or learning a particular thing, what we call a specific learning disability. The second thing is we have to rule out whether the child has attention span problems in the form of hyperkinetic disorder or ADHD. I think we have to do that. Let them also meet a pediatrician. Yeah.
Sure, sir. Second is from the same parent of increasing blood and body because of underweight.
I mean, how do they know that blood is on the lower side, or why do they think it's underweight?
No idea. Tanishka's parent, can you please come in and check it out?
Yeah. Thing is, like, when we check from starting itself, she is eating less food, and her weight is a little bit worried. When you compare that with other children, their weight is a little less. So I think.
Okay. See, we usually don't compare children's weight with the other children. One child's weight with other children, because children tend to grow like their parents. So if the parents are on the thinner side, children tend to be on the thinner side, because ultimately the growth depends on the genetic characteristics. If both of you are on the leaner side, and while growing up you were also on the leaner side, your child is going to grow in a leaner manner only. So no matter how much nutrients or calories you pump in, the child is going to grow according to its own growth charts, growth curves. So don't really worry about it. What you have to worry is whether your child is healthy or not, whether your child is not falling sick often, whether your child is active, playing, whether your child is sleeping well. So these are certain parameters that you have to really worry about. Don't really worry about weight issues of your child looking at other children, because your child is going to grow very similar to how you are growing.
Okay. The same parent has one more question, that she has some heat boils on the buttock area, and any cream or ointment would you like to suggest?
No. I wouldn't teleconsult unless I see it.
Okay, sir. Next question is, do we have any specific height or weight balance chart for an Indian kid?
Yeah. I mean, they have to just Google IAP growth charts.
Okay.
Indian Academy of Pediatrics. IAP growth charts. So you have growth charts for girls, growth charts for boys. You have charts showing you the required height, weight, body mass index.
Okay.
For that particular age, so they can always see. They could also use what is called as a Google calculator. You have certain calculators. You can just type in WHO growth calculators.
Uh-huh.
So once you go to WHO growth calculator, it will ask you the age of the child, the weight of the child, and height of the child. So it would calculate and tell you whether the child's height, weight are okay for its age.
Okay, so next question is, my son keep biting his lower lip at the time, so how can I stop this? I keep telling him not to do.
How old?
Sumit's parent, is it his second grade or third grade? Probably 9 years ago.
7 years old. Okay, yeah, it's again they are called as they are all part of this behavioral personality disorders. You know, few mm-hmm. children keep sucking their thumb. Few children, as they have mentioned, keep biting their lower lips or upper lips. Few children keep biting their nails. They are all behavioral, not really disorders. You know, personalities. So what is required is certain behavioral modifications. There are certain reinforcement techniques. Reinforcement techniques like positive reinforcement or negative reinforcement, and those things can be done while at home. You know, now actually it's a good it's a good time to go ahead, because you are staying with the child and the child stays with you. There's schooling going on. So what you have to do is go and discuss these things with your pediatrician. Ask the pediatrician to help them out with certain reinforcement techniques, behavioral modification techniques. The commonest used are reinforcement techniques and also timeout. So they can go and discuss. They're easy. I mean, though it takes time, you know, it takes about a year to get rid of certain bad habits. So it's just a bad habit. You know? That bad habit needs to go. For that bad habit to go, there are certain positive and negative reinforcement techniques. It will take time. It will take about a year or so. But it can be done. They can go and discuss it with their pediatrician. Yeah.
Okay. The next question is a little bothering. My daughter getting too much of smell, and the age is, and this age, it is becoming a problem to her. She's around 7 year old.
Okay. I can understand. See, you know, 7 years, it's not too early. I would say, especially nowadays, girls have started entering into this process of puberty by the age of around 8 or 9. 7 years is not too early, but okay. So what happens is, during this period of growth and development, certain changes happen in the physical body as well as the mind. So in the physical body, commonest things that start happening is the sweat glands, which were not developed till then, because of certain hormonal influences, start maturing. So when they start maturing, they start certain they start secreting, and also certain glands surrounding the sweat glands, they are called as sebaceous glands, will also start maturing, and they will also start secreting these the substances that lead to this peculiar odor. This is a part of normal puberty. No, you need not be worrying too much about it. Of course, I can understand that the odor that comes out of it can be certain, sometimes disturbing. You should be worried if, along with this, the child has started premature development of breasts or premature development of hair in the axillae. So if any of these things are there, along with this malodorous sweat, I think you need to consult your pediatrician. If the problem is restricted to malodor or a bad odorous sweat, you can use deodorants. Let her just wash with clean water twice a day or thrice a day. And very important is dietary modification. Ensure that she hydrates herself quite well, drinks a lot of fluids, avoids, I've already told you, fast food, saturated fatty food like chips, wafers, cookies, biscuits, pizzas. Eats lots of
chocolate add in here.
Pardon me?
Will chocolate add in here in the saturated section?
Of course, you know, I mean, you can't allow children to have chocolates every day.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, so green leafy vegetables. To that, I would also add red meat, you know, a lot of red meat. Of course, you increase green leafy vegetables, and eggs are okay, boiled eggs, and pulses. Millets are better always than cereals, you know.
Okay. How many eggs per day can a child have, sir, if it is within age 10?
No recommendation as such. We usually say no, not to give more than 2 boiled eggs.
Okay. Next question is, my son having white patches on his cheeks, particularly in winter season. Any suggestions?
Probably he must be having having what we call as winter dermatitis. It's quite common. They can just apply Vaseline petroleum jelly or coconut oil or extra virgin olive oil twice a day.
Okay.
That should be enough. Yeah.
Okay. Any particular soap kind, like moisturizer rich soaps? Nothing like that.
No. Okay.
My daughter is having cold in the morning. She sneezes a lot, and after some time it is okay. Early morning sneeze.
Yeah, I mean, this is again quite a common thing nowadays. We call it as reflex rhinitis.
Mm-hmm.
Certain reflex, triggers can cause acute rhinitis. And rhinitis is nothing but inflammation or allergy of the inside of the nose. So that irritates the inside part of the nose. And in order to overcome the irritation, they would either sneeze or keep blowing their nose. So probably here the trigger is waking up. So early waking up or waking up from sleep is one of the commonest triggers for rhinitis or these sneezing episodes. It could as well be a part of what we call as allergic rhinitis. But because you've told me that it just lasts for a few minutes, I don't think it is allergic rhinitis. Probably it's a reflex rhinitis. It tends to improve with age. Nothing needs to be done, or rather nothing can be done. Only thing is, if possible, after getting up, if she can take hot steam, can sometimes be helpful. Otherwise, it would get better with age. She will have to outgrow it.
Okay. Can our family do deworming every 6 months?
Not required.
What about the children, sir? Deworming?
See, the national guidelines say that till the age of 5 years, once in 6 months, deworming is required. Beyond 5 years, it's not really required.
Okay. Other than that, any more questions? Any parent? Any questions, parents? So when it comes to special needs, at what age can we recognize?
Depends on the type of special need.
Okay. I mean, like, how do we, you know, recognize that my child needs help? Symptoms or any...
The type of help depends on whether the help is social, physical, or psychological.
Okay. And there's no particular symptom that emerges or any physiological problems that comes out to...
It's quite simple, I told you. It could be physical help, psychological help, or social help.
Okay.
Physical help, few children are born with certain physical defects. They will require help right from the time they are born.
Yeah.
Social health or social deficits can be picked up as early as 10 months to 1 year.
Okay.
Social health disorders like autism.
Yeah, eye contact. The first thing.
Then psychological help or cognitive help. You tend to get to know these kind of things by the age of as early as 2 years. But few children, it can be delayed up to 4 years. Because that also includes children who are deaf, that cannot be picked up in few children due to various reasons.
Okay. Can you please talk more on the importance of vitamin D? The latest question.
Vitamin D, see, contrary to the name, you know, it's not just a vitamin. It's a molecule that has got a lot of ramifications, you know. It is required for normal functioning of the muscles, because vitamin D directly influences the functioning of calcium or the requirement of calcium in the body. And we know calcium is required for almost everything. Calcium is required for normal functioning of nerves, normal functioning of muscles, normal functioning of bones, to keep it as basic as possible. So when calcium is involved in normal functioning of muscles, muscles are present all across the body, all over the body. Muscle is also present in the heart. Nerves. Nerves are present, you know, all over the body. Nerves are required for proper functioning of the muscles. And number three, proper functioning of the bones. So it's as simple as that. Vitamin D directly influences the metabolism of calcium. And calcium is required for each and every important function of the body. So in that way, vitamin D becomes very, very important. And that's one of the reasons why nowadays we have started supplementing all children who are born till the age of 1 year with vitamin D supplement.
Okay.
And because of our so-called modern lifestyle or westernized lifestyle, we are coming up with a lot of vitamin D insufficiency disorders, because we are hardly going out into the sun, and most of the time we are inside. We are completely covered. One of the most important sources of vitamin D, natural vitamin D, is sunlight. So we are not going out into the sun. So that is directly leading to vitamin D insufficiency and deficiency status. So that's why we should make children play outside at least 3 hours a day in good sunlight. Morning between 8 and 9, evening between 4 and 5, and afternoon if possible. Otherwise, at least 3 hours of good sunlight needs to be there for normal natural vitamin D to be synthesized. That also holds true for us, you know, especially people beyond 45, 50. We hardly go out into the sun. We are most of the time confined in AC cabins, and AC further aggravates vitamin D deficiency or insufficiency. So we also have to go out, get some sunshine. Yeah.
Okay. There is a feedback from the parent Sumit Singh. The person says that it's a very good session and they are quite informed. And thank you for that. Yeah. The next question is, we have been told many times that differently abled children have some protein deficiency. Is that true? Also, they describe as many supplements in this recommended.
Yeah, that again depends on the type of different ability that you are talking about. See, the most common physical disability that we come across is a condition called a cerebral palsy.
Mm-hmm.
Cerebral palsy is a condition wherein the brain is affected when the child is in the uterus or just after the child is being born.
Yeah, so the child who's referring is an ADHD child with food sensitivity.
Okay, there are not all ADHD children are sensitive to certain foods. Few children, I mean, there has been certain research going on whether ADHD children are particularly intolerant to certain proteins. But that's not really true. Of course, about 10% of children with ADHD can have a concomitant comorbidity in the form of protein intolerance. But that's not a general rule.
Any food supplement that you would recommend where the child can have it?
No, none. None.
Because I know the child hardly eats anything. I mean,
yeah, that comes with ADHD, you know. Yeah, that behavior comes with ADHD. It has got nothing to do with the child not feeling hungry or not having appetite. that's a part of behavioral problem that has to be addressed by behavioral modification rather than any drugs or supplements.
Okay. And there is one more thing, any good healthy food tips that you would suggest?
Yeah, I mean, I've already discussed this, you know. Let me go back and again try to give you the mantra, you know, that our grandparents used to follow. In my case, even my parents follow, and I have started following it for the last decade, and I think it has actually made wonders. Maintaining a healthy weight. Maintain a healthy weight. Okay? You should not feel that you are
heavy,
overweight or underweight looking at yourself. That's how I would term it. No? Look yourself in the mirror and you should feel that you are not overweight or underweight. That's very important, number one.
Okay.
Number two, please be physically active. They have to sweat it out at least 3 hours a day in sunshine, in sunlight. For me, I ensure before the lockdown, I used to swim 1 hour every day. I used to meditate and do pranayama 1 hour every day. So that is how I usually keep myself fit. If you have access to swimming, nothing better than swimming every day. Please swim. If you don't have access to swimming pool, jog. Please don't go for ridiculous slow walking. It makes no sense. Either you brisk walk or jog 1 hour a day.
Okay.
Important eating nutrition tips, whole grains. Always choose whole grains. If you are a facultative or an obligatory rice eater, go for whole rice, not the polished white rice. Go for whole rice. We in this part, we call it as kuchlakki or kempakki.
Okay.
That is always better than going for polished rice. Polished rice is not good. That is one of the main reasons why diabetes is on the rise. Whole rice is very good. Whole grains in the form of millets, ragi,
millet,
jowar, very important. I'm not too sure about wheat because I don't eat wheat because wheat contains gluten. I try to avoid all gluten-containing cereals.
Okay.
All fruits, vegetables, pulses, especially sprouted pulses. I, as an adult, I mean, anyone who is beyond 20 years of age, make it a habit not to eat after 7 in the evening. Because if you hog after 7, your hogging is usually followed by a masterly inactive status activity in the form of sleeping. That will derail your entire digestive mechanism and homeostasis. Adult, as an adult, you can eat. You can easily survive with 2 meals a day. 3 meals are not required. Definitely no snacking. 2 meals are sufficient. This is true for children beyond 21, adults, not for kids. Kids can eat 3 times a day and snack in between. But for me and you, all adult parents, try to set a habit or try to set a pattern of not having to eat more than 2 times a day. Fast at least twice a month. I do fasting on Ekadashis. I also have started fasting on Chaturthis. So you can easily fast 2 times a month. You can build it up to 4 times a month, complete fasting. 2 times only eating.
Okay.
And your second meal should be before 7 p.m. Please limit fast foods. Don't get into this habit of eating fast foods. Limit your fast foods to either idlis or upmas or dosas. Please don't limit, please don't include pizzas, burgers, KFC outlets and all those things as fast foods. And please limit red and processed meat. If you are a obligatory meat eater, from obligatory meat eater, try to become a facultative meat eater. If you are a facultative meat eater, try to come down to a very, very occasional meat eater. Okay? That requires a lot of motivation, a lot of inspiration. But believe me, that can help you a lot in the long run. completely curtail your sugar sweetened drinks. Get your children out of this habit. Never use sweetened drinks or sweetened beverages or chocolates as a rewarding technique. Don't tell your children that, okay, you do this. If you do this, I'm going to get you a chocolate. Or if you do this, I'm going to get you this sweet. If you do this, I'm going to get you a Coca-Cola or Fanta or something. Don't use it as a reward. Never. And set an example by yourself not drinking. Or even if you want to drink, please don't drink in front of your children. And as I've already told you, please don't consume alcohol or please don't smoke in front of your kids. So this is my mantra. Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you for that, sir. Next question is, my son is doing mirror image and writing. So how do I help him or what do you suggest?
Okay, that's a...
He's 6-year-old.
Yeah, probably... he has got some learning disability in the form of dyslexia. It requires proper intervention. I can't help you on this teleconsultation. They will have to meet a pediatrician and also a psychologist and a speech therapist. They will be able to help him. Yeah.
Okay. There is one more question. My daughter is 7 years, but her height and weight is 10-year-old. Is it fine for growth?
Probably even... Parents are on the taller side. So she is growing according to their parents. Yeah.
Okay. Height is also more, it's leveling to the age group. Is it fine? Is what the parent is asking.
Yeah, I mean, they will have to look into the growth chart.
Height is 10 years, weight also.
Pardon me? Both height and
height. Height says 10 years and the weight also.
It's okay.
It's okay. I have my personal question. As you were speaking about rice eating, my son, he is very fond of rice and he doesn't eat anything else. So should I switch to red rice or is it okay?
He's around 10 years. I told you. That's okay. I told you. Whatever I spoke was for people beyond 21. For kids growing, it's okay. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Anything more? And there are many feedback saying they got a lot more information and they were happy with the information.
So let them pay me then.
anybody else? Yeah, my sons are 8 and 11 year. I feel they have put on weight and please suggest how to help it. What is the proportion of carb, protein and vitamins in our diet?
Mm-hmm. So regarding putting on weight, I think the pandemic has only worsened this lifestyle. So I think they'll have to go out and start exercising, or at home they can start exercising, either skipping, what do you call it, sit-ups, and then screen time. You know, I know it sounds ridiculous, but you know, somehow you'll have to get rid of the screen time. Except for online learning, I don't think they should be allowed to use the screen for any other thing. So engage them in one-to-one contact, avoid getting them saturated fats, food from eateries. And while they're at home, try to inculcate this good habit of exercises. You know, morning, let them do sit-ups 50, evening 50 sit-ups, morning 100 skips, evening 100 skips. Let them do things that can be easily done at home. There are very good YouTube videos about exercises in children that can be done easily at home. So you can just go to YouTube and type exercises for children at home. So they need to start doing that. Apart from that, I don't think you can do anything right now. If you think the child is, both the, your children are gaining weight in an accelerated manner, please you meet your pediatrician. Sometimes certain disorders can also do that, but unlikely in your children, because if both of them are gaining it, probably it's because of their wrong lifestyle that has set in this pandemic. So they will have to eat less, eat less of what do you call saturated fats or processed food. Let them eat whatever is prepared at home and start exercising. Yeah. And the second part was what?
Proportion of carb, protein and vitamins in our diet.
See, the proportion that is required for a balanced diet keeps changing with age. For children, around 60% of meals should be of carbohydrate, and around 20 to 30% should be protein. About 10 to 15 should be fat, and the remaining should be vitamins and trace elements. This doesn't hold good for me and you. This is for a growing child. For grown-ups like us, it's different. You need not have to have 60% of carbohydrates in your diet. You need not have carbohydrate at all in your diet. So that's a different discussion altogether. For a growing up child, it's 60 carbohydrate, 20 to 25 proteins, 10 to 15 fats, and the remaining vitamins and trace elements.
Okay. And there's one question. My son is 7.5 and he only likes milk and milk products and egg. He hardly eats any vegetables. Weight and height is fine. How do I replace the vegetables?
Yeah, I mean, this is called as food fadism, or what we call as picky eating habits. I think this is a behavioral, again, a behavioral thing that has set in. You know what? All these food-related problems have aggravated in the last 2 decades, you know, because of our family structures. We have chosen nuclear families over joint families. All these social modifications have had this impact on our upbringing of kids. What interventions can be done for this particular child is to start this modification, behavioral modification called as family pot feeding, wherein all the family members sit together and try to feed the child or make the child feel that it's a family activity, it's an important activity of the day. This is a very good, very important reinforcement technique that can be followed. You know, any fussy child, picky eater, can be made to sit in between, and family members can sit around the child, eat from a single thali. So these are certain behavioral modifications that can be done. Regarding your child getting stuck to only milk and eggs, this again requires negative reinforcement as much as positive reinforcement. This requires family pot feeding technique, and unfortunately, unlike in the Western countries, we don't really have what are called as food clinics. Now, there they have what is called as food clinics, wherein all these children with eating-related behavioral problems can be treated quite well. But here we don't have. But in this pandemic, what you can do is, if you have a small society or a colony, you can sit together and eat. Of course, by maintaining physical distancing. Yeah.
There's an 8-year-old child mother who's asking, my child is mostly in playing mode. How do I bring him to studying mode?
I don't have an answer to that. No.
Neither do I.
Yeah. It's probably, I mean, I may sound harsh here, but I think it's inconsistent parenting. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Karen, ma'am?
Yes. Hello.
Yes, ma'am. We can hear you.
We can break. I think that was the last question for now. We thank the parents actually for giving their questions here. And more than everything, I thank Dr. Vikram.
Thank you.
Dr. Vikram, thank you for giving your time and your very patient hearing and your answers. I'm sure the parents have benefited. And actually, we've also benefited listening to you over here. So 1 hour, but very informative. Yeah. So on behalf of the school, I'd like to thank you. And I thank Sucheta also for arranging to get in touch with you and for
thank you, ma'am.
Yes. Yeah. Thanks, Sucheta. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
So have a nice day. Bye, parents. We'll catch up again with some event like this. And I'm sure we'll benefit in other ways as well. Yeah. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, ma'am.
Bye.
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 Shall I end the session?
Yes, Sucheta. Thanks, Sucheta. We'll catch up with you.
Sure.
You can end the session and you can personally thank the doctor again from our behalf. Yeah.
Sure, ma'am.
Yeah, we'll catch up. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.